Thank you. It's been said that one of the marks of a Christian is that they pray. I think you agree with that. That's one of the things that Christians do. And yet we have a tremendous amount of questions about prayer. What should we be praying for? How should we be praying? When should we be praying? How much should we pray over something? Is God listening? Will He answer? We have all sorts of questions about prayers. Today's worship focus would urge us to pray for what God has already claimed for us. Forgiveness, eternal life, spiritual blessings. Instead of always what we want from Him. May God the Holy Spirit fill you with wisdom as you consider your prayer life and offer your God prayers that are acceptable to Him and therefore answered by Him every single time for your good. But good morning and welcome to all of you. If you're using the hymnal for your order of worship today, we begin on page 154. If you're worshiping virtually today, please send me a text message or an email. That information is useful. Let's join in the opening.
Paid for my sins with His innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner.
Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace to good men. We praise you, we bless you, we worship you, we glorify you, we give thanks to you for your great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sin of the world, receive our prayer. You set the right hand of God the Father, have mercy on us. For you only are holy, you only are the Lord, you only, O Christ, with the Holy Spirit, the Most High, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord, your ears are always open to the prayers of your humble servants who come to you in Jesus' name. Teach us always to ask according to your will, that we may never fail to obtain the blessings you have promised. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The congregation may be seated. For this Sunday, our first lesson is from the Old Testament book of Genesis, chapter 18. In this reading, we have the excellent example of Abraham, who prayed to the Lord with confidence and persistence. Then the Lord said, "The outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is so great, and their sins so grievous, that I will go down and see if what they have done is as bad as the outcry that has reached me. If not, I will know." The men turned away and went toward Sodom, but Abraham remained standing before the Lord. Then Abraham approached him and said, "Will you sweep away the righteous with the wicked? What if there are 50 righteous people in the city? Will you really sweep it away and not spare the place for the sake of the 50 righteous people in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to kill the righteous with the wicked, treating the righteous and the wicked alike. Far be it from you. Will not the judge of all the earth do right?" The Lord said, "If I find 50 righteous people in the city of Sodom, I will spare the whole place for their sake." Then Abraham spoke up again, "Now that I have been so bold as to speak to the Lord, though I am nothing but dust and ashes, What if the number of the righteous is 5 less than 50? Will you destroy the whole city for lack of 5 people? If I find 45 there, he said, I will not destroy it. Once again, he spoke to him, what if only 40 are found there? He said, for the sake of 40, I will not do it. Then he said, may the Lord not be angry, but let me speak. What if only 30 can be found there? He answered, I will not do it if I find 30 there. Abraham said, now that I've been so bold as to speak to the Lord, what if only 20 can be found there? He said, for the sake of 20, I will not destroy it. Then he said, may the Lord not be angry, but let me speak just once more. What if only 10 can be found there? He answered, for the sake of 10, I will not destroy it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm of the day is number 138. Today's psalm takes the form of a hymn. We'll join together in singing the verses of the hymn. For there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. This has now been witnessed to at the proper time. And for this purpose, I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I am telling the truth, I'm not lying, and a true and faithful teacher of the Gentiles. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 11. We listen as Jesus himself teaches us about prayer. This reading will serve later as our sermon text. One day Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples." He said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sins against us. And lead us not into temptation.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Suppose you have a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. A friend of mine on a journey has come to me, and I have no food to offer him.' And suppose the one inside answers, 'Don't bother me. The door is already locked, and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything.' I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, yet because of your shameless audacity, he will surely get up and give you as much as you will need. So I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
The congregation may be seated. Children, I've got a message I'd like to share with you this morning. Let's sit over here today again. It's good to see you today. Days in which you get presents?
Birthdays and Christmas.
All right, birthdays and Christmas. Maybe your grandma or your grandpa would visit you and bring a present along, but Christmas and your birthday, those are 2 days when you usually get presents. So let's say that you asked your parents for a bicycle for your birthday and they gave you a rock. Or, what if that you asked for a game that you've been waiting for, a video game, and you opened up the box and inside was this piece of trash, chunk? Or let's say you're shopping for school with your parents. It's time for school to begin and you need things like a pencil, right? You need a pencil at school. And your mom gave you this broken crayon. What good is that? Would your parents ever do that? No, they would give you what you need. There are times when people pray to God and they are not sure that God will give them the best things, what they really need. They doubt. They think, maybe God has something against me. In fact, if we recall our sins, you know, the times we've been disobedient, etc., right? Or you haven't been nice to your brother or your sister, or you haven't been very careful with the things that you have, you broke them, maybe even on purpose because you threw it down. We remember those times when we've done things wrong and then we wonder, well, I don't think God likes me anymore because I prayed for these things and I'm not receiving them. Jesus talks about prayer today to us. And he says, your Heavenly Father always gives you the best gifts. Like a bike? Like a video game? No. At the end of the reading, he says, the Heavenly Father has given you his Holy Spirit. What? Yeah. When you were baptized, you became a child of God. The Holy Spirit made you a child of God. That's the greatest thing. Because now you have the forgiveness of sins and eternal life. You could have all the money in the world and you couldn't buy forgiveness for one sin, but you have it because you have the Holy Spirit. You could have all the money in the world and you couldn't buy 1 second of life in heaven, but heaven is yours because you have the Holy Spirit. He's brought you that gift. So when you're wondering what to pray for, here's something you can always pray for, and know that your Heavenly Father will always give it to you, the Holy Spirit, and all the blessings that God wants you to have. And you can always do that trusting that God will give you what you truly need. Okay, you go back and sit with your parents. We'll join in singing the hymn of the day, number 725. Acceptable to God or not? that's the way it is so often, isn't it? We're wondering if what we're about to pray for, what we are praying for, is indeed acceptable to God, if it's acceptable to Him. And I know this doesn't help you with this issue, but that's nothing new. Followers of Jesus Christ have always been wondering about their prayer lives in response to the faith that they have and the love of their Savior Jesus Christ. Is what I'm praying for pleasing to God? Am I praying to God in a way that pleases Him? Those things have always been on the minds of God's people, and it was on the mind of one of Jesus' disciples here in our text from Luke chapter 11. Jesus was praying, our text says, and one of the disciples noticed that, and in response to that, he says, "Lord, teach us to pray." Our text says that they were in a certain place. It's difficult from Luke's gospel to determine exactly when in Jesus' ministry this account occurred. But I'm of the opinion that it occurred months into, if not a year into, the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ. As such, the disciples had opportunities over and over again to witness Jesus praying. In fact, maybe even praying out loud. They heard what Jesus was praying. And they realized, my prayer life just doesn't measure up. And so the question, the response, Jesus, teach us to pray. And Jesus was only too willing to teach this disciple what to pray. In fact, our text says, he taught all of his disciples. And as he does so, the reaction of those followers was just what our reaction is today. We evaluate our prayer lives. We wonder what we should be praying for. We wonder how we should be praying. If those are the questions on your minds this morning, then you're at the right place at the right time, because here Jesus this morning is going to be the master teacher once again. And as we sit at his feet, he's going to teach us how to pray. May the Holy Spirit bless his words and our study of these words this morning. A few days ago, as I was preparing for this sermon, I decided to Google, how should I pray? And as expected, I got a dozen pages or more of links, some of them containing videos. So I decided to click on some YouTube videos about how I should pray. I don't recommend it. It wasn't worth my time. In one of the videos, the person making the presentation encouraged me to pray to God and then listen for God to answer. And then he went on to explain to me how I can be sure this is God's voice speaking to me and not something or someone else speaking to me. I said, yikes, I don't want to go there. Another presenter did a great job of explaining where you can go in the Bible when you're not sure what to pray for. But the thing he didn't do was go here to Luke chapter 11. Why wouldn't you listen to what Jesus has to say in answer to your question, what should I pray for? How should I be praying? Well, that's exactly what Jesus does here. He is the perfect prayer. So let's listen to what he has to say. When I read these words a few moments ago from the lectern, perhaps you noticed, hey, this kind of sounds like the Lord's Prayer, but it's not the Lord's Prayer that we use. You're right. That's because we're accustomed to speaking the Lord's Prayer as it has come to us from Matthew's Gospel, which Jesus spoke during his Sermon on the Mount to what Matthew says was multitudes of people, and that was at the beginning of his ministry. As I mentioned, I'm of the opinion that this occurred later in Jesus' ministry, and he's not before multitudes of people. He's there with his 12 disciples. And so he teaches the lesson of how to pray. Once again, he just doesn't use the same words as he did earlier in his ministry. On this day, he taught his disciples, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sins against us. And lead us not into temptation. Let's take a brief look at what our Savior taught us. Five petitions. Five things he instructs us to ask for. Four of them are for spiritual things. Hallowed be your name. When we pray, hallowed be your name, we are asking our God to cause his word to be taught in its truth and purity. The name of God is his word. So we're asking God to cause his word to be taught in its truth and purity, and we as God's children to lead godly lives according to it. Thy kingdom come. We are praying for God to send us His Holy Spirit through His Word, to bring us into His kingdom by faith in Jesus, and to increase our place in God's kingdom by increasing our faith in Him. Likewise, we are also praying for God's kingdom to come to others through the preaching of His Word. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. We're asking for our God to justify us. That is, declare us not guilty. It's a courtroom term. As guilty as we are of sin, Lord, declare us to be not guilty for the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ. And out of love and appreciation for that forgiveness that is ours, lead us to forgive others as well. And finally, don't lead us into temptation. Rather, Heavenly Father, keep temptation away from us. And when you allow temptation to come, give us the power through your word to overcome and win the victory over that temptation. 4 spiritual blessings. And in there, he also adds, give us each day our daily bread. Daily bread includes everything we need for our bodily lives. Every day of our earthly lives. We're praying, Heavenly Father, give us what we need each day to live our lives here. And then cause us to appreciate that daily bread and to receive it with thanksgiving. 4 spiritual things, 1 earthly thing. When you pray, what do you pray for? Well, the priorities are obvious here, aren't they? When our Lord Jesus teaches us how to pray, he says, keep your priorities on spiritual things. In the Sermon on the Mount, he said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these earthly things will be given to you as well. So keep that as your focus. When you're wondering what to pray for, recall what your Savior teaches. First and foremost, pray for spiritual things. But Jesus is not giving us a rule book here. He is not giving us the exact words to say every single time we pray to him. If it's on your heart and in your mind, if it's an earthly thing, then pray to him for it. If it's a concern to you, it's on his mind and his heart as well. But when you pray for earthly blessings, are you under the delusion that if God gives you this blessing, finally you will have the happiness in your life that has been evading you all this time? Don't fool yourself. Even if God pours out abundant blessings on you, far more than you ever prayed for or could have imagined, if they are earthly things, they will never give you the satisfaction that you're looking for, because you will still be living with that abundance, that earthly abundance, in this world of sin and sorrow. Jesus did not come to this earth in order to make this life pleasurable for you. He came to win eternal life for you. And it's yours by faith in him as your Savior from sin. And along with that salvation, your Savior promises to give you whatever else you need for this life, because his goal for you is eternal life. Do you pray for the right things? Ask yourself that question and learn from your Savior, Jesus Christ. You know, Jesus often said things that are difficult for us to understand, at least at first blush. For instance, in one of his parables, he talks about a dishonest manager. And he commends the dishonest manager. Is Jesus urging us to be dishonest? Well, obviously not. In the second half of our text, Jesus says some things that might be difficult for us to understand. He talks about a man who has a friend, a friend come traveling to him, and he's got nothing to give this man, and it's midnight, but oh well, he walks next door and he starts pounding on his neighbor's door, and the neighbor answers at midnight. He says, you know what, I've got a friend that came here, it was unexpected, I've got nothing, can you give me 3 loaves of bread? And the guy said, are you nuts? It's midnight. If I give you that bread in this house, this biblical period house, I'll wake up all my children. I'm not going to disturb them. Get out of here. But the man keeps pounding. And Jesus says, not because of friendship, but because of this guy's shameless audacity, the neighbor will give him what he asks. So what is Jesus teaching here? Be persistent in your prayer life. Persistence. Take the example of Abraham from Genesis chapter 18, read earlier. He was persistent in his prayer life. Jesus urges you and me to do the same as we pray to our God. And pray confidently. Jesus uses the example of a boy asking his father for something good. And Jesus says, look, no earthly father, when asked for something good from his son, would give him something harmful, would he? What's the point? Jesus says, look, if you, though you're sinful and your knowledge is limited, you still know what are good things to give to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven know what to give you, the one who is all-knowing and all-powerful? Jesus says, when you pray, pray confidently. The right way to pray to your Heavenly Father has complete trust in Him, meaning that you are confident He can give you anything that you need. Your Heavenly Father sees the future, your future, perfectly. He knows exactly what you will need in this life in order to meet that future. And if you ask Him for something which He knows in the future will not be helpful to you, He will not grant it. You can pray to Him confidently that He will always give you what is best and right at the right time. In fact, Jesus says, if you want a yes answer from your God to your prayers, then ask Him for the greatest of all gifts, like I told the children earlier, the gift of the Holy Spirit. There is no greater gift, because what the Holy Spirit brings you is eternal. What the Holy Spirit brings you blesses you eternally. Pray for the Holy Spirit to come to you through word and sacrament, and God always answers that prayer with a yes. So how should you pray? Absolute confidence in your Heavenly Father, persistently. Do we pray that way? Well, there's a temptation for us to view prayer as a game of chance, right? We toss our prayer dice, and we wonder what the odds are that it's going to come up yes. That simply isn't true. There's no chance left to your prayer life. Your God always answers every one of your prayers in the way that is best for you, at the time that is best for you. You can count on it. There's no chance to it. Your Heavenly Father has one goal in mind for you, and that is for you to reach eternal life with Him. He's won that life for you by the life and death of His Son. Won't He also then do whatever else is necessary for you to attain that goal? Those are the lesser things. He's already done the greatest thing. Count on Him. Pray for spiritual things. Prioritize them over earthly things. Pray persistently and confidently, trusting that God will indeed answer your prayers in the way that is best for you. Christians, pray. Christian, pray. Confident of God's blessings. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We join now in speaking the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Almighty God and Father, we thank You for all the mercies, Your mercies, especially the gift of Your Son, to whom You have revealed Your gracious will. We praise You for the Holy Spirit and His working through the means of grace.
Plant Your word in our hearts and cause it to produce fruit in our lives.
Strengthen and defend Your church, that by Your word and sacraments faith may grow and love toward all may increase.
Support all who spread the light of Your truth throughout.
throughout the world.
Keep our children in the grace of their baptisms. Enable their parents to train them in lives of faith.
Raise up Christians to serve you in the ministry of the word and in all godly walks of life.
Preserve our nation in justice and honor. Guide and bless all who make, administer, and judge our laws.
Give them wisdom that they may promote justice and hinder evil.
Let your blessing rest on planting and harvest, commerce and industry, medicine and science, the arts and culture. Protect all who travel and care for those whose work is difficult or dangerous.
Be with all who devote themselves to any useful task.
Comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. This morning, compassionate Father, in your mercy, we remember that you transform even sickness and disease into a blessing for your children. With this confidence, we commit all who are sick or suffering to your tender care. We pray especially for Lou Ludke's niece, Lisa, who has cancer. Provide healing and relief according to your infinite wisdom and boundless mercy. Grant patient endurance if her suffering must linger. Help her find true spiritual strength through Jesus and his cross during this time of physical weakness. By the work of the Holy Spirit, teach her to trust in your forgiveness, your grace, and your love. Remember those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those for whom death draws near.
Grant them your love and take them into your tender care.
Hear us, Lord, as we pray in silence. We remember with thanksgiving those who have loved and served you, who now rest from their labors. Console those who are mourning or living with sadness.
Keep us in the true faith, and bring us at last to the joys of heaven.
Grant us these things, Father, for the sake of Jesus, who died and rose again.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for the offering.
Amen.
living.
May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your holy word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for the closing hymn. Edition of the Wells Connection. After that, we'll have a couple of announcements.
Hello, I'm Wells President Mark Schrader. We've all heard the media reports about recent college graduates settled with enormous debt. It's true, the cost of delivering a quality education is increasing, but it's also true that Martin Luther College has a laser-like focus on affordability.
common scenario. A young person is considering a career in full-time ministry, but they're not quite sure. They'd like to try Martin Luther College to test the waters, but they fear running up debt from tuition and fees. To alleviate that concern, in partnership with incoming students and their families, MLC has set a goal that no student will need to take on loans for that first year of college. It's so important that young people who are willing to consider ministry are not discouraged from pursuing that goal because studying at MLC is too costly for them.
Don't forget that the public ministry is a way to make an eternal difference in the lives of people every day. We're talking about things that will make a difference forever. And that, to keep that in front of them too, so they don't just get paralyzed thinking about dollars and cents.
The plan is part of a larger effort at MLC to create an appealing yet affordable campus experience that will attract the next generation of young people considering full-time ministry.
Right now I'm planning on MLC as a teacher track. I would really like to teach music or maybe elementary. I haven't decided exactly, but that'd be really awesome.
I wanted to be a teacher. That was the only thing I wanted to do, was I wanted to teach little kids about God's word and help them get where I am now.
Taking on some college debt isn't necessarily a bad thing for a college student. The key is to keep it manageable. That's why MLC is focused on ensuring the total debt of its students stays below a level that's 50% of the average starting salary of a Wells teacher. It's a reachable goal if we all share in the effort, parents, students, and members and congregations.
I do not think that you overestimate the importance of this place. If we want the gospel to live on, not only for us, but our children and our grandchildren, and for those surrounding us in our communities and world.
Another key part of the effort is financial education for the students themselves. Nearly all MLC students now receive a financial wellness training to learn about budgeting and balance sheets, to prepare for their personal lives and their roles as church leaders.
That's huge asset to be able to have a program that talks about these things, breaks it down into simple steps, and makes it approachable. Why wouldn't you want your kid to have that kind of experience as well?
Nearly every college and university faces financial challenges, but Martin Luther College is dedicated to minimizing the debt of our students so they can focus on lives of service for your congregation and the world.
One of the ways that our church body is helping Martin Luther College provide tuition assistance funds is through the Wells Martin Luther College Endowment, which distributes over $125,000 per year. To learn more about offering gifts for tuition assistance at MLC, contact mcg@wells.net.
Something our congregation is an opportunity we have out there, and that is supporting our members who would choose to go on to Martin Luther College through our ministerial education and student assistance fund. Those envelopes are on the table in the desk, on the desk in the narthex. Pick one up on your way out. If you have questions about that, let me know. Just a couple of announcements. Next Sunday, we'll have our quarterly meeting with the Voters and the Women's Guild. Make plans to join us for that. We also have the trip to the Creation Museum coming up, and to speak to you briefly about that is Steve Watcher.
We're still on for August 3. I hope the sign-up sheet is no indication how many people are actually going to come. My count, I think we have 3 families with children, and I'm going to say 6 to 8 empty nester adults, so I think we're going to have a decent turnout. I think we have drivers lined up. There's a lot of things here. A lot of people give me, I'll call it a soft yes instead of a definite yes, and I'm going to try to firm that all up. I want to give people time to get ready. I figure if you get to church by 10 o'clock, hopefully you can get in church again on August 3 at 10 o'clock, and that will give everybody, we meet here, we'll decide who's in what cars and decide a little bit how we want the day to go. This is very informal, so it's we're going to let people decide how they want to handle things, and we may all stay together or we may part ways, just depending on what everybody wants to do. I think it's going to be a good time. By the way, we announced that we were going to pay for kids. That was very generous of us, considering this year Creation Museum is offering kids admissions 10 and under free. So, that wasn't a trick. I didn't know that would be enough. But so 10 and under are going to be free anyway. We'll see if we can help subsidize some other things because of that. So that's about it. If there's any questions, I'm around today.
Thank you, Steve. And thanks for joining me today. God bless your week as you serve your Savior.